Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Muhammadin wa alihi al-Tahirin. Wa la'na da'ima ala a'da'ihim ajma'ina ila yawm al-Din. Yaqul Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fi muhkam kitabihi al-Kareem. Kitabun anzalnahu ilayk litukhrij al-Nas min al-Dhulumati ila al-Nur. If we look at this verse from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the book, He says, I descended a book and a prophet. I descended this book to whom? To the prophet, so that he may guide people, take them out of darkness into light. So if we look at this specific verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put two conditions to guidance or hidayah. He said, one, you have to go through that book, and two, through that prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you don't have these two ingredients, no guidance whatsoever. It's a guarantee. Now, what happens here? If we have two ingredients, we look at history and we analyze quickly those who try to shun one of the ingredients, what happens to them? We start with a man in history who stood by the Prophet ﷺ on his deathbed, and he told the Prophet, he didn't say the Prophet is delirious. He said this man is delirious. يعني نفى النبوة. He said, حسبنا كتاب الله. I don't want the guidance from Rasulullah and the book. Just from the book. Allah, the irony is, if you study history, you see that this guy knew nothing of the book. So what do you want from the book? But when he did this, he goes on, because he's not guided, because he left one of the two ingredients, he goes on to murder the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the issue with guidance is not just guidance. There's a danger also, that if you leave these two things, there's misguidance. So if we look at history, let's just look through the chain of history starting from, we're going to skip some members, but the Bani Umayyah, starting from Muawiyah, Yazid, Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, skipping some, going to Bani Al-Abbas, Al-Harun, Al-Ma'mun, Al-Mansur, Al-Mu'tamad, Al-Mu'taz, Al-Mutawakkil, and I'm not saying them in order, but all of them committed atrocious things in history, but what? Most of them were Huffaz Qur'an. Some of them also narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then how come there's no guidance? Let's look at an example in the life. I believe it was Al-Mutawakkil. May God curse him. Al-Mutawakkil, one time he was the Khalifa, and a man was leading prayer. The man went out and he recited Surah Al-Nasr in the congregation. Surah Al-Nasr, you all know it. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Iza ja'a Nasrullahi wal-Fath. وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسِ يُدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. The man, instead of saying that, and the verse continues, he said, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرَ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسِ يُخْرُجُونَ مِنْ دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. The man looked at him, Mutawakkil, I believe, looked at him and he said, وَيْحَكْ, what are you saying? The word of God is يدخلون. He said, آه, يدخلون عوقت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله. أما عوقتك أنت يخرجون من دين الله. Why? This is the verse. يُخْرِجُهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. But if you don't follow the proper traditions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is what happens. Let's go a step further. Today, we have people who have the Quran. Actually, they have studied the Quran, at least in Hufuz, more than us. The Salafi Wahhabi, satanic ideology. They know the Quran better than us. When they talk about traditions, they quote Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they give you the entire chain of narration and they start هذا مرفوع هذا متواتر وهذا وهذا. They're just good at throwing words, but they go back to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yet they commit the most heinous crimes and the most atrocious things. يعني they're a threat to humanity and to civilization. So what's missing? If Allah said go with the book and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will be guided. How come they're not guided? Some will say the intention has to be pure. Some of those Wahhabi Salafis, when they enter, they really believe, as you guys know, in Lebanon, it's very common, they say this, أنه راح يتغدى مع الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, right? They really believe, some of them, that they're doing something good. They're serving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So is the intention alone enough? No. Absolutely not. There needs to be hidayah and tawfiq, and you need to get that third ingredient. What is that third ingredient? Forget that we're the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam for one instance. Let's start with the Quran again. Or sorry, with the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah starts and says in his wasiyah, إِنِّي تَارِكُمْ فِيكُمْ الثَّقَلَيْنِ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ وَعُطْرَةِ أَهْلَ بَيْتِ. And he puts it like this. You all know the story. مَا أَن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا. If you hold on to them, تَمَسُّكْ, hold on tight. You will not deviate after me. But what's supposed in here? That if you don't hold on to either of them, there's deviation. Allah doesn't throw words like that. Neither does the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, stick to them like this, تَمَسَّكْ, you will not deviate. But if you leave one of them, you will deviate naturally. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes further. He looks at Ali alayhi salam and he says, Ya Ali, they will fight me for the tanzeel and they will fight you for the ta'weel. What does this mean? It means that they will fight me about the Quran, but for you, Ya Ali, you're the difference. Because if you want to be guided by this Quran, obviously you have to understand this Quran. So they will fight you for this Quran. So then what's that missing ingredient? Now, to find that missing ingredient, we go back to the Quran al-Kareem. Surah al-Nahl, verse 43. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Was'alu ahl al-dhikr in kuntum la ta'lamun. Who are these ahl al-dhikr? Again, take the Shia hat, or the followers of ahl al-dhikr, away. We want to talk Quran and tradition. So, first we've established, there's three ingredients to guidance. The book, the Prophet, and these Ahl al-Dhikr. The Quran says, when you don't know, go ask these Ahl al-Dhikr. He started with singular, saying the Prophet, and then he made it plural, Ahl al-Dhikr. So first, to understand, who is the Dhikr in the Holy Prophet? When I say Ahl al-Dhikr, I need to know who Dhikr is. Two possibilities in the Holy Quran. We're going to take one by one. We'll start with the Quran itself, the tradition. Then we'll move to be Quran tradition. We start with the dhikr being Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For his love, send a salawat. The dhikr being Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We start with the verse of the Quran in Surah Al-Talaq, verse 10 and 11. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends to his Prophet, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, قَدْ أَنزَلَ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ ذِكْرًا رَسُولًا يَتْلُ عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ. Allah says, I've descended upon you a dhikr, a prophet, that sends his verses or recites his verses upon you. Allah described the word dhikr as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is from the Quran. So if we take the word dhikr, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, we switch it into Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or we switch the word dhikr into Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You say, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. واضح؟ واضح. Who are أهل الرسول sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Very simple. From the Quran to the Quran. Then we go to the traditions. Quoted from their books and ours. The Prophet himself sallallahu alayhi says, أَنَا الذِّكْر. And that's why further you see in history, Imam Ali alayhi salam says, نَحْنُ أَهْلَ الذِّكْر. Now let's say the other possibility. Does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say that the dhikr is other than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Quran? Yes, he does. He says the dhikr is the Quran itself. We'll take another verse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the dhikr is the Quran. In Surah Al-Hijr, verse 9, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna nahnu nazzalna al-dhikri wa inna lahu lahafidhun. We have descended this Quran and we are its protector. Allah used the word dhikr for Quran. So what happens now? He said, Fas'alu ahl al-Quran in kuntum la ta'lamun. Who are ahl al-Quran? Who other than the ones in whose house the Quran was revealed? But you know what? Again, we remove that Shi'i hat and let's talk Quran again. We say, is there another verse that talks in more details about these people, the Ahlul Quran? The people who actually have the right to talk about this Quran? Who Allah has bestowed and endowed them with that knowledge? Na'am. We go to Surah Al-Waqi'ah, verse 79. لا يمسه إلا المطهرون. Who are these mutahharun? Illamis, we're not talking fiqh here. This is descended from God. We're talking about the people who have the essence of the book. The people who have the right to explain what this book contains. The people who understand it, who have this ma'rifah. We go. Who are these mutahharun? You all know the verse 33-33 from Surah Al-Ahzab, the most recited verse in our faith. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna ma yurid Allah liyadhhab ankum ar-rijs ahl al-bayt wa yutahhirakum tathira. Who are the mutahharun? The ahl al-bayt. Who are the ahl al-Quran? The ahl al-bayt. Now we take a tradition from Imam Ali alayhi salam himself. This one's narrated from one of the most mutaassib in history. Al-Askalani or Al-Askalani, whatever they call him. He says, Imam Ali alayhi salam in many occasions in his life stood on the pulpit. Not in one occasion, in many occasions. And he knocked his chest. And he said, Saluni saluni kabla an tafkaduni. Ask me before you lose me. By Allah, ask me anything that may happen from now till the day of judgment. Anything that may happen. By Allah, ask me anything about this Quran. If you ask me about any verse, whether it was revealed in the day or the night, on a plain or on a mountain, I will tell you. These are the Ahlul Quran, from the traditions. So when we say, فَاسْأَلْ أَهْلُ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, whether it's the Prophet or whether it's the Quran, we know who these people are. So what's the missing ingredient? The Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. So it's one thing to accept the book and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, like the Wahhabis do, but it's not enough. Because we see what they're committing in the name of the religion without any understanding. Like parrots who recite all day. Now how is this all linked to Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam? Because this is the topic of our discussion today. Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam, we're going to recite two quick accounts of his life. One, did we know that Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam has a tafsir al-Quran mansub ilayh? Yani there's a tafsir that was written or dictated, excuse me. It was dictated by Imam Al-Askari to one of his companions. What's ajib, people will say he's an imam, it's simple, it's easy for him. Sahih, it's easy for him. But I'm not even comparing the depth of the vault. Because if we're impressed by such great tafsir as Tafsir al-Mizan, Tafsir al-Burhan, and these, it would not compare to the tafsir of Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam. So we're not talking about the depth. We're talking about the actual volumes. Imam Al-Askari, like doctor said, His Eminence said, he was martyred at the age of 28 years old. Imam Al-Hadi alayhi salam, his father and him used to live in Samar, in Medina, and they were under house arrest. They were forcefully moved to Samarra. One of the reasons he's called Al-Askari, there's two reasons, we'll just look at one. One of the reasons is that Samarra had become a type of military base. So he was under confinement, so they called him Al-Askari. And they used to watch out for him for many reasons. They used to send him to Baghdad to a very, very atrocious jailer who used to punish him and torture him. And then they would keep him at home waiting for the Hujjah, Hajjallahu ta'ala Farajul Sharif. That's why his wife, the wife of Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam, had many names in history. They wanted to kind of hide when the Hujjah would be born, Hajjallahu ta'ala Farajul Sharif. So Imam Al-Askari was under all this pressure. He dictated, yani in Arabic, Amla. Do you know how hard it is to dictate 120 volumes? And our ulama say, there's a debate right now. Some say, this is just juzu of the tafsir. It's a part of the tafsir. It's not even the full tafsir, the 120 volumes. Some say this, some say it's the full tafsir, but it's not present amongst us. But the imam was dictating, and when you dictate to someone, first of all, at the time, there's no typing. You had a feather, and you used to dip it in ink, and you would scribe. And then dip it in ink and scribe. And when the ink dries out, you go get more ink. When the feather breaks, you have to buy a feather. The difficulty in putting that together in 28 years under house arrest, worrying about your son, worrying about your wife, of the affairs of the Muslim and the Shias, and was almost impossible. How did this Imam alayhi salam put 120 volumes? And this man, which most people would say miskeen, 120 volumes of handwriting, well, this man had the biggest tawfiq. A direct link to his imam serving him. And this man, you know when you dictate, I don't know if I mentioned it because I'm getting a bit excited here. When you dictate, you have to go back after and make sure that the scribe wrote properly because it's a wajib shar'i. You don't want a mistake. So he was able to put at least 120 volumes out there. So one of the examples The great Sayyid Khu'i, rahmatullahi alayh, he was very rigorous to study narrations. And he said, I studied this narration thoroughly, and I found that this book, or this tafsir, is 100%, the people who transmitted that it exists, it's 100% sahih, very trustworthy. So the Imam was able to establish this. Now just to look quickly at the conditions of the Imam alayhi salam when he lived. Number one, the Imam, three quick accounts. The Imam, the hadith that we should wear the ring on the right, obviously it's a prophetic sunnah. But one of the reasons, one of the hadiths we got this from was Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam. He says the signs of a believer are five. One of which is التخطم باليمين. At the time of Imam Al-Askari, he contradicted his own words. Yani he was forced to contradict his own words. He said, أمرناكم بالتخطم باليمين. والآن نأمركم بالتخطم بالشمال. فإنه أدل دليل على ولايتنا أهل البيت. عليهم السلام. طبعا, at the time, not today. At the time, he told his Shias, wear the ring on the left. Why, ya Imam, you told us to wear it on the right. Imam Al-Kathim says that Imam Ali wore it on the right because the Prophet wore it on the right. He says, I fear for your souls. Another tradition, two men, one from Halab and one from the town. They came, they wanted to visit Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam. Imam Al-Askari sends them a letter and he tells them, do not visit me. He tells them, if I come out of my house, do not salute me. Do not point to me, saying this is the Imam. Do not even look at me or give me a sign with your head or your eyes, because I fear for your lives. This was the state he was in. On top of that, people will say these are narrate. Let's go to one of the famous world travelers, Ibn Battuta. In his Rahalat, what does he write? The Moroccan Sunni Maliki. What does he write? You guys, the Malikis pray like us, like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to. So he says, I was praying in one of the countries and people started staring at me. They thought I was a muwali of Ali alayhi salam. I was nervous. So what they did is, they brought me, you know, qatl ala al-hawiyya, like it's happening right now in Syria and Iraq and elsewhere. Same thing at the time. Actually, it started from there. History doesn't change. So they said to me, come have some rabbit meat. Rabbit meat is halal for them, haram for us. So if he was to eat this rabbit meat, they would know that he's not a muwali. But if he was to refuse it, there's a problem. So they served him rabbit meat, and this is his words in his own book. These are historical things you can verify. They left him alone. So these were the conditions the Imam was living in, and he was able to put out 120 volume at the minimum, the aqal al-taqadir dictated and what we explained right now. Now the question is us. So this is all grand. He's an Imam. Are we, nahna ourselves, seasonal Muslims that we only show up in Shahar Ramadan and Shahar Muharram and after that, Allah mish mawjood, the a'imma mish mawjoodin? Is that truly our faith, nahna? Dua kumil, 5-6 people? This is how we pay back the Imam and the amana he left with us? Ajallah ta'ala farj sharif. Is it not shameful for us? And I speak to myself. I'm not speaking to any of you. I'm speaking to us collaboratively. Is this acceptable from us? That our Imam gave his life. He was imprisoned, he was, and he gave all this jihad. And nahna, that's all. Nahna, we pray, we fast, wa salam. No, this is not acceptable. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was expecting, because he knows, he created us, and he knows our futra. He was expecting us to say what? To say, this is a prophet. You know, when you say, oh, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi used to help his Jewish neighbor, or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi used to forgive, or bifatah Makkah, right away we say, mashallah al-akhlaq, but ask a person, do like the Prophet, but this is the Prophet. But Allah knew this. What does Allah say to us? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, لَكَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةً حَسَنًا لِمَنْ يَرْجُوا اللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. But what does that mean? Does Allah say, لَكَدْ كَانَ فِي رَسُولَ اللَّهِ? No. Allah doesn't miss anything. Allah says, لَكَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ. Nobody else. لَكُمْ. No excuse. فِي رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةً حَسَنًا. Is it only His akhlaq? No. Because Allah says, I have not created the jinn and the ins except to worship. Every movement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi's life is a worship. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi was foremost in doing, not talking. When they built the first mosque, Rasulullah put his hand first. He did not wait. فَنَحْنَا, our complacency and our apathy is not acceptable. It's not acceptable. نَحْنَا, we don't know where our shabab are.
when they're not in here and they're not learning, where are they? How are we going to learn a religion? And if people say, I'm still young, Malak al-Maut has no age. We're hearing about people dying at a young age nowadays. We'll take a story quickly from a man from Jabal Amir, who was one of the greatest scholars of our faith in history. Al-Hur al-Amili, radwanullahi ta'ala alayhi. He was 10 or 11 years old when he was hit with a terminal illness. They told his parents, Khalas, your son is going to die. Al-Hur al-Amili went to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And he said to Imam Hussein, everyone has to die. At what? At 10 or 11 years old. Now, this is how we should teach our children. He said to Imam Hussein, everyone has to die. However, I do not want to meet my Lord empty-handed. Ya Hussein, do what you have to do. I beg you. Salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, he doesn't refuse people. He's too kareem for that. He lengthened the life of Al-Hur al-Amili, and in return, Al-Hur al-Amili gave an encyclopedia of 30 volumes or 29 called Wasail al-Shia, which is heavily relied on as our traditions. There's no excuse. A man in terminal illness. The second account of the Imam's life, his connection with the Holy Quran. This one's against the philosopher Ya'qub ibn Ishaq al-Kindi. Ya'qub ibn Ishaq al-Kindi was praised by one of the Italian scholars of his era, saying this is one of the 12 abakira of the world. One of the 12 people that are the most genius in this world. He had written 230 or 300 books, depending on historians, in philosophy, in astrology, in astronomy, in mathematics, in optics, in medicine, in iqtisad, economics. This man had lived with Abu Hanifa. So, if you consider Abu Hanifa alim, he lived in the circles of ilm. Then, he had lived with Ma'mun. If we don't consider Abu Hanifa alim, at least Ma'mun, we have to admit that the man was known as the erudite of Bani al-Abbas. That's why we have Gharib al-Tus known as the erudite of Al-Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So here he lived with Ma'mun. Ma'mun told this man, Al-Kindi, he told him, I want you to translate the books of philosophy of Socrates, Aflatone, Plato, and the third was Aristotle. So he was at that level. Al-Kindi, the way it says, Tafarrah lil-Quran al-Kareem. Al-Kindi, promoted by the emperor of his time, sits there and he decides, I'm going to leave all my studies and I'm going to write a book that proves that the Quran has contradiction, therefore it's not from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Imam, alayhi salam, the riwayah says, Tasadda lil-Kindi. What does he say? He says, you want to come near my Quran? My God's Quran? No. This is again a parallel. When the Prophet was insulted, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, what did we do? It's not the Shaykh's responsibility. It's our common responsibility. If we care for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we can't sit back and say it's okay. No, it's not okay. We have to, obviously, in a civilized, proper, polite way, defend the honor of our Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what does Imam al-Askari do under the conditions we described at the beginning in the 120 volumes of Quran? And where does he have time to answer a philosopher of this magnitude who was born in 184? He was 47 years older than the Imam alayhi salam. And the Imam has access to nothing. One of the students of Al-Kindi goes to the Imam. The Imam says to him, is there not a pious man among you that will tell Al-Kindi to stop or teach him to stop? He says, if Abu Hanifa couldn't stop him, you think we can? We're his students. The Imam alayhi salam says, no problem. If you will do me this favor, follow what I tell you. The man says, absolutely. The Imam tells him, whatever I tell you, please listen to me. And this is what will happen. The Imam describes the whole occurrence. When you do this, he will reply this. Then you do this. We won't go into much details. The man goes to him. The Imam tells him, Latifu. And speak to him with lutuf. Make him comfortable. The Imam wasn't speaking from the area of ilm al-ghaib. He was speaking from ilm al-nafs. He was explaining to the people or the way to do da'wah. The way to enter someone's heart and then to pull out what you want. Yani the way we should be spreading the message of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wa salam. So the man goes to him, the Imam tells him, be friendly with him. The man starts being friendly. After a long period, the Imam also instructs him, be patient. After a long period, he feels that Al-Kindi has become very comfortable with him. So he does what the Imam told him. He tells the Imam, he tells Al-Kindi, something came to my heart and I want to ask you, do you mind? Al-Kindi says, of course, go ahead. He tells him, is there a remote possibility, a small possibility, that what the Mutakallim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his book, the Holy Quran, meant something other than what you understood? Al-Kindi stood and he said, there is a possibility. Why? Because it became mukarrar. He admitted there is a possibility. And the Imam had told him, Al-Kindi is intelligent. If you speak to him in honesty, he will open up. So Al-Kindi said, there's a possibility. So the man said to him, what the Imam had told him he would say this. He told him, say back to him, then why a smart man like you would make such a statement? Because there's a possibility that you're wrong, essentially. I'm paraphrasing. And would you want to be the one that's shown to the world, Al-Kindi made a mistake in his assessment when the Quran says itself that there are verses that are clear, muhkama, and mutashabihat, ambiguous? The man took the book he had written and burnt it. In four little words, the Imam alayhi salam was able to destroy this philosopher. And this is not just a word of ibrah. This is a duty on us. When our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is being attacked or anything else happening, to stand up. Obviously, bil-ilm. We don't want to act like Salafis. No, absolutely not. So what's the moral of all this? It's our connection with the Holy Quran, because Rasulullah left two amana. He left the Quran and the Ahlul Bayt. We have to analyze how much time, if Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam spent most of his time in jail, essentially, in his home, tortured in the living conditions we described, and he still produced this much, and he still gave the Quran this much attention, what are we doing? We, like the Quran said, we have deserted this Quran, we've made it a book on our shelves, and some of us, my own Quran, Al-Attar, and it's got a smell, and it's just sitting there. Yani shame. That's a shame. These are the words of Allah. So I'm going to end with two really quick stories. One is about a scholar in Qom. It's a true story. And another true story about a khatib that was also either in Najaf or Qom or Karbala. I'm not sure. But you know, to understand the benefit of something, to be guided, we said you have to have a relationship with the Quran. You have to understand the Quran. So to understand the value of something, you have to have ma'rifah of the thing. For example, take a child right now, give him a check, a piece of paper, and write $10 million. And give him a toy, and tell him, pick. What's he going to pick? The toy. Why? He doesn't have ma'rifah. He doesn't know that this is not comparable to that. This lack of ma'rifah makes the child pick the toy. For him, this is a paper. Same thing. Bring gold. Give the child chocolate. He'll pick the chocolate. He doesn't have ma'rifah. That's why Imam al-Rida alayhi salam says, "Man zarani fi ghurbati 'arifan bi haqqi, wajibat lahu al-jannah." You want this benefit? Understand the reality. So this man, he read a verse in the Holy Quran that said, "Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa nunazzila min al-Quran ma huwa shifa'un wa rahmatun lil-mu'minin, wa rahmatan lil-mu'minin." He said, "This book is supposed to be shifa and rahma." How? He said, "I started pondering. I decided I'm going to build a relationship, because if to me the Quran is a book like it was to Muawiyah and Siffin, useless. Because the Imam Ali told them this book is mere paper and ink. But if this book becomes really guidance and the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will have an earthly benefit before the Akhirah." What does this alim do in Qom? He starts taking the Quran and he starts reading daily and pointing this finger. It's known in Arabic as a sababa, right? He starts pointing the finger like this on every verse. And he says, one day, 2 days, 1 week, 2 weeks, 1 month, years. After a while, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made his... I'm sorry, I'm going to end right now. He made his finger have shifa. He was known among the ulama, people who had cancer. God, inshallah, Allah yib'ad al-shar ankum, jami'an. He used to come to this man and he would cure them with his finger. He said, because the verse says shifa, I believed in it and I actually acted upon it and I built this relationship. The same about Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. And I like to end everything with Sayyidah al-Zahra alayhi salam and begin everything with her. And hopefully she can forgive me for missing little details. There was a khatib, and this is the last story. The khatib, I believe he was in Qom, or I don't know, 100%. This Khatib had a gift. His gift was, because of his purity and the way he had connected with Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, every time he would start a majlis, he would say, Sallallahu alayka ya Aba Abdullah, and the place would turn into cries and wailing. He didn't start the majlis. Why are people crying? He had been given this gift. So one day a smart youth came up to him and told them, Shaykhna, Mawlana, tell me, what's your gift? How did this happen? He told them, this happened one day. I used to read majalis for Aba Abdullah alayhi salam. And then one night after the majlis, I came exhausted. You know, some of the Qurra al-Aza in Shahr Muharram, they stay after. And they have the walima and they talk and answer questions and so on and so forth. This was a guy that was exhausted. He came home and he removed his abayas, and he went, he's about to rest, he wants to go to sleep. The door knocks. He opens the door, he sees a man. He tells the man, can I help you? He tells him, I have a majlis aza, I need you right now. The sheikh told him, Habibi, I'm too tired, I can't. I just gave 10 or 12 nights. He told him, Sheikhna, I have a special guest, I need you at my majlis. The sheikh became shy. The sheikh said, okay. He was tired. He put on his abaya. He put on his hat. He didn't know what was waiting for him. He arrives there. It's an open room. There's nobody there. Nobody. It's a black room. مغلفه بالأسود بالسواد. ودخل. He sees a chair. The man says to this, the sheikh says, this guy, something wrong with him. He brought me. I'm exhausted at night to give a majlis to who? So the man tells him, تفضل اقرأ. The Sheikh says, لمن أقرأ? He tells him, اقرأ لفاطمة عليه السلام. Is she present or is she not present? Amongst us now, is she present or is she not present? Our behavior should be how? Our behavior should be how? If we forget that Allah, if we forget, لا سمح الله, لا سمح الله, because we should not forget Allah. Know that in the Majalis al-Aza, Fatima is here. So the man gets shy and he starts reading. The minute he says, Sallallahu alayka ya Aba Abdullah, he hears the voice of a woman crying. Salamullahi ta'ala alayha. And since that day he was gifted because the connection was real. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi.